My name is Richard Sutton. I am author of Fear of Becoming a Man. I am from Philadelphia, and I'm just up and coming author trying to get my name out there and make some impact as much as possible. As crazy as this sounds, wasn't something that I was aspiring to do. It was kind of more of a spiritual thing. I woke up one morning. I kicked it around about becoming an author, writing a book, but I was like, whatever. And I woke up one morning and the name of the book was on my spirit real heavy. And it was just like, name the book Fear of Becoming a Man. I tried to ignore it, whatever, but it was bigger than me. Definitely, it was one of those things where it was just pushed through me. A lot of times, I always say that I struggle with inconsistency at times. I'll start something out, but this wouldn't let me stop. I jumped when I started writing. It kind of just moved, and it wasn't a thing where I had to really think or process hard. It was just movement in it, and me going just the way it was flowing and putting it together, and it kind of freaked me out. But it's about my life in a lot of ways, and just my struggle, my pains, my growth, my truths, So it's just me standing in my truth, hoping that it's something that someone can read it and take away from it and say, okay, possibilities. No, you know what's funny? I think the most, but I read a lot of motivational books like 16 Laws of Success by Napoleon Hill, and things of that nature. That's the kind of stuff I read. But then I picked up one of the most profound, one of the most powerful books, hands down, that I've ever read. And it was The Alchemist by Pablo Coelho. And it was, to me, it spoke on so many different levels. And the movement in that book, I would be humbled to be even that much close to writing something so powerful, of literary work. To me, would be like, that's crazy, because that was a powerful book for me. I love it. It's one of my favorite books. I let a friend of mine hold it, and he kept it too long. I was in my feelings. So I'm not lending any more books out after today. I think you do if you want a person to be engaged into what it is you're trying to express through your work. I think it's definitely, and you have to know who your readers are. I think that you once you have a target audience, you have to cater to that target audience. I can't write this book and say I'm going to cater it to infants or whatever. You know what I'm saying? You have to understand what your target audience is and what it is that you can add to them. You know what I mean? And I feel like when you write a book, this is like a relationship, right? If I can't come into a relationship and have nothing to add to it. But I think usually it's what you're inspired by. Right? What inspires you, who inspires you, and how it inspires you all impacts what it is you do to inspire. Right? And so, like you said, with those type of, that genre of literary work, then they understand that there's a target audience for that. So they focus in on that audience. But I think the reason why you can focus on that audience, mm-hmm. because something about you is about that audience. So then you can then in turn approach that audience. I wrote this book, about Fear of Becoming a Man, because I felt like it could give some assistance to a young man growing up and having some struggles about what becoming a man looks like, because I think there's no defined answer to what becoming a man is. We can't define that. Is there universal laws attached to it? Without question. But I don't think any of us can truly, because your experiences and my experiences are going to be somewhat different, even though we have similarities. So my take on what it is to become a man and your take may have some type of nuances in it that kind of deflect from each other. But we're both saying the same thing, but we're speaking from our experiences. But I think those universal laws and principles are universal, period. And so I my thing in fear of becoming a man is we all have fear, especially if you came up without a father showing you, particularly a black man, because I feel like our plight is different from everybody else's. So being a man and then becoming a black man in these United States, you need some guidance. And I hope that anybody that picks this book up can get a little bit of guidance or make them think outside of the box about what their approach is. Why not? You know, a basketball player can't go play ball if he don't play ball, right? If it's not something I do, how can I really perfect the art? So I feel like, you know, read when you read different things, one, I feel like it expands your vocabulary, which to me is the most important, right? But two, you also get an opportunity to see the different approaches different authors take to cater into their audience or pulling their audience in. Like Omar Tyree, right? He wrote his books, right? And he kind of catered more to the single woman, right? And that whole niche, right? But he found this niche, he did it, and that's what that was his thing. And I think it's just finding your lane, or more importantly, creating your lane. I want to be able to create my lane versus find my lane, because if I create it, then I mean I can cement it, you know. So, you know, and I think, to me, even in the title of the book, the thing that sticks out to me the most is the four-letter word, fear, right? Fear can have such a mixed impact on how it impacts a person and how it a person is moved by it. You can either be moved to do or moved to not do, or moved to not ever do because you're so stuck in what may be because you never took the chance. And you have to, at some chance, take a chance. And so to me, fear of becoming a man is a lot of men are, they fear to become that man. And that's why even in a picture, the little boy is looking at himself in the mirror. But really, I wanted the man to have such a hint of fear in his face, like, yeah, this is about to be something different for you. Right? But you see what you're about to walk into, and that's what it's about. And don't allow that fear to stop you from becoming the man that God put you here to be. One of my goals is I really wanted to be in a position where I start traveling and speaking. That's one of my biggest goals. And to ultimately, my other bigger goal is I have an academy called the Amari Academy. And Amari stands for strength. And I cater to young boys between the ages of 12 and 18. And we teach them leadership, money mindset, self-respect, self-value, how to treat, speak, and talk to a woman. But ultimately, too, I get them personal journals. I get them journals. And the journal has the Amari Academy on the front of it. And the inside, it has my PDQ logo. But then the pages, at the bottom right hand of the pages, it has their name on each page. And so try to teach them how to express themselves through journaling, put their thoughts on paper, to learn how to be expressive that way. And I think that was one of the best things that happened to me. And I didn't get to start doing that until I was like in my mid-20s of doing it. But I think now I can go back to that journal and see the Richard then and the Richard now. I can see the growth. I can see the mindset change. Struggles, you know, struggles are struggles. That's what life is going to do. But I could see that the impact has been different. So my ultimate goal is to get this to the New York Times bestseller list, to become a powerful speaker, and to buy my alma mater, Germantown High School, and turn it into the Germantown High Amari Academy, and teaching all those principles plus entrepreneurship to the kids, so they can be more of a pillar in their community. Graduate, and if they decide to go to college, cool, you go to college, but come back and be an impact to your community and do be a part of some type of change to affect the ripple effect that you can cause. One of the most powerful things happened to me was I had my class, and I pulled up on YouTube the story of Black Wall Street, and had the kids watch it, had my boys watch it. And one of my boys turned and he looked at me. He said, "Mr. French, they would never show us this in school." I was like, "That's why I'm showing it to you." Right? Because this is something that you need to know that they won't let you know. So now you know. Right? Because, you know, everything you're getting pumped with is strategic. But you got to understand there's so much more to us than what you've been given. And that made me feel good that I gave him something that was impactful. And one of the things my sister said to me, my sister is a teacher, an older sister, and she said to me one time, she had me do a financial class for her kids at the rec center she runs, because my background is in banking. And she said, "Here's what you gotta understand." She said, "With kids, you may never see your work pay off." And I had to rethink about that, but it made sense to me, because in the book I talk about a teacher that changed my life educationally wise, because they had me labeled as having a learning disability, which I really didn't. But I think labels are another way to stagnate a kid's mindset. Because if you're telling me that I can't learn, well, why the hell should I learn, right? So I talk about him, and I don't know if he's dead or alive, but he doesn't know what he did for me. That's how I look at my approach now. Like, well, everything, I speak at schools, I done spoke at grads, I done spoke at most of the schools, you know, and so my thing is, if I can save one kid. Well, it's funny, because everybody keep asking me, what's the next book, especially the way this ends. And they're like, and I keep telling people once again, I didn't set out to be an author. I was moved to do this. So for me to do it again, it'll be something that I was moved to do, right? And just trying to be obedient to that higher power. And then the other piece is I'm very conscientious of my energy and what I allow to impact me. So I'm not a news watcher. Right? Because that it spews negativity 24/7. And I feel like there's so much more positive things that's going on right here in my favorite city, right? But we're not going to put that out there. And even when it is something positive, you give it all of less than 20 seconds, right? But you'll keep refeeding to me the shooting that just happened down the street over and over and over, right? And so I try to be conscious of what impacts me, because I understand that the news is controlled by a bigger power in this country. And right. So they want you to, if I feed you enough to do this, you're going to believe it.
Right.
Right. Just like when Donald Trump was on that whole rant about President Obama wasn't American born. And then you had folks believing it because over the loops, they kept looping it of him saying it. So other people started to believe it, even though it was false information. So I'm very conscious of that. I try to stay in a positive mindset as much as possible. People are like, well, how do you know I should? I'm like, because if it's something that needs to be known, I'm going to know. I'm going to find it out. Right? Between social media and people talking, I'll find it out. So I'm not a news watcher at all. But I get exactly what you're saying. And I think that writing usually, I feel like to me sometimes the best writing is things that inspires that writing. It's kind of like even musicians, when they go through something, that'd be their best album. So, because anytime you speak from an organic space and place, that organicness can be felt when read, when heard, because it's organic. And organic speaks positive energy. The overall message would be that you can't allow anything to stop that in which you're supposed to become. You cannot allow fear to castrate you from becoming what it is that you see in the mirror every day that God has already put on you. You have to give yourself an opportunity to take a chance at becoming that in which you were put here to become. Well, I think, here's what I love about young people. Like, I've been working with young people. I was just doing something. I had a little program I was doing with a subsidiary of the JJC for a couple of months, and I was working with some youth. And the thing I love about the most is that if you're phony, they pick it up like that. They're like pit bulls. If you're fake, they know. You cannot come to them kids being fake or have any type of fakeness to you. They pick it up, right? But I also understand that these kids are impacted by images. I can't just tell you that you have the possibilities to live beyond that in which you believe, but I also have to show you with the images. And that image has to be me first, right? Because if I can come in and I'm consistent in what I'm saying to you, giving to you, and showing you, then at some point they will start to believe. They're inundated with stuff that you and I wasn't inundated with. And I think that a lot of adults disregard that. Like, these kids are dealing with so much more than we had to deal with, right? And so they got so much negative energy coming to them, so much negative TV, social media, you know, then the things on the streets. And so they're inundated with this. So when you give them a piece of something different, they're going to fear it until they consistently see it. Now, when I consistently see it, I don't no longer have to fear it because it's reality. You know why? Because it's tangible. Right. So when you pose your question, how do you show a kid that all he sees is negativity and he believes that he can't live beyond a certain point? You just got to touch him and show him that it's real. So your possibilities is my possibilities, and my possibilities are your possibilities. The next story I would like to write is that I spoke life into the universe, that these are the things I wanted to accomplish. One of the things I want to accomplish is getting this book into Steve Harvey's hand, to sit in front of him and have a conversation about it and have him sign off on it and say, this is a good book. You need to go get it, right? Because once that happens, it opens the doors to other possibilities. So I've been just putting it out there. And I feel like, you know, if I keep putting into the universe what I want to happen, at some point it's going to deliver it to me. So when you say what's next, what I'm gonna write about next has yet to be penned, because it hasn't happened. But when it happened, it'll be penned. I want to be able to come back and write a story that can be, I can be very defined and strategic in writing it, that that in which you breathe life into is possible. So that's what I would love to do. Follow that voice, that internal voice that speaks louder than anything that you can hear outside of your external. And if you follow that internal voice that speaks louder than everything external, it will lead you to where it is that you're trying to go, do, conquer, and create, right? Because I think a lot of times we disregard that internal voice. That internal voice is there for a reason. It was given to us for a reason. But we either second guess it, ignore it, or challenge it versus listen to it. And what I'm trying to learn is to listen to it. Right. The question is asked, what is it that you want me to be? What am I doing? What am I not doing that I'm supposed to be doing? Or am I doing what I'm supposed to be doing? And I just got to be steady in my due diligence and patience, because you got a bigger thing for it. And I believe that because the way this was given to me, I truly believe that this is going to change my life. My purpose has been driven by this. And this is the catalyst to open the door. So listen to that inner voice, right? Know that your possibilities is what it is. And breathe life and speak life into that it is and what you would seek to achieve. Well, to get the book, you can go to my website at www.fearofbecomingaman.com. On there, you can read excerpts about what people have already said about the book. You can see what I got going on, where I've been, where I've spoken at, interviews. Even if you go there now, you'll see on my website that I'm here with you on my website, right? So that, and you can purchase the book from there. As far as social media, if you go on Facebook, Instagram, or Twitter, and so if you type in Mr. PDQ, I'll come up. I go by Mr. PDQ on all my social media. If you read the book, you'll understand why I go by Mr. PDQ, right? If you go on to YouTube, you go to under PDQ Management, you see different places where I've already spoken. So, you know, I could be booked through that, through my Fear of Becoming a Man website as well.
Rachel Slaughter, the Executive Director of Literacy University. Real Education TV. We will tackle sensitive issues plaguing public education. This groundbreaking show celebrates real learning, real education, teachers in the trenches, and real results. Our viewers will be riveted by our discussions with administrators and students in the middle, making decisions. By tackling sensitive subjects, we will eat the elephant in the room one bite at a time. Red, Real Education TV.
Indicator.
Enough said on that.
Yo, what's up? You know what it is. It's your man, the Indicator.
Holla. Tune in, man.